Soil water repellence is quite common in Western Australia, and that's because we have sandy topsoils that are prone to having water repellence. And about 20% of our soils, agricultural cropping soils, are affected by soil water repellence. It's typical of water repellent soil at the end of summer, I guess, in that, you know, if you just scrape away that surface and you get down into the topsoil organic matter, you put the water on there and the water will just sit there and it just won't soak in. It'll just sit there on the soil surface, and it's just really expressing that soil water repellence. For soil water repellents, there's quite a number of options that people can use. They can try and improve the seeding process to try and actually get more effective establishments. So that might include things like using soil wetters or on-row sowing, or perhaps using paired row seeding, some of the methods that people use. But in terms of soil amelioration methods, there's also things like soil inversion, rotary spading, clay spreading, clay delving. And I guess when it comes to some of those amelioration techniques, which involve strategic tillage, I guess one of the advantages of them is that it can also have an impact on some of those other constraints like compaction and soil acidity and incorporating lime. But because a lot of, in terms of a lot of the sand plain soils in Western Australia do have like multiple soil constraints, so they're often affected by all three of topsoil water repellence, soil acidity, and subsoil compaction. And so if you address all of them, what we find is that you get a better response in terms of the actual productivity that you achieve, but you also tend to get a longer lasting response. I guess one of the key things to start with is to actually look at the soil pH and get some deep soil testing done, because lime can take quite a long time to actually change and fix the soil pH, and the longer you leave it, the bigger the problem becomes and the longer it will take to fix. So certainly understanding that, it is possible too just to use field observation and that to assess whether you've got repellent soils. If in most seasons you're having establishment problems and the soil is not wetting up well, that's a sign that the repellence is quite severe. And then with compaction, you know, you can just use probes or penetrometers to sort of try and look at that. In terms of looking at deeper compaction and maybe doing some of the deeper ripping, sort of below 40 centimetres, you probably really, ideally, you'd want to be in a controlled traffic farming system before you do that so that you can maximise those benefits. So you're targeting a soil which actually has reasonable potential, but is quite constrained by those soil constraints. Those areas are good to target because you can actually get quite a large and sustained yield benefit, because the soil is inherently quite productive. It's just quite strongly constrained. Certainly it is possible to sort of lift up areas that are poor performing in paddocks, and that can sort of improve that overall paddock's productivity and the profitability over that whole paddock. Here we've got a replicated field experiment that's funded by the GRDC and DAFWA through the Soil Water Repellence Project. And it was established by Giacomo Betti and myself. And we're looking at managing multiple constraints: the topsoil water repellence, the soil compaction, and the subsoil acidity. The results here have been quite encouraging. In the first year, we've had very good yield responses to the spading in particular, but also to the claying. Using multiple strategies to tackle multiple soil constraints, we found that, you know, we can improve profitability by anywhere from $20 to $200 per hectare per year for at least 10 years or more.